But I'm here tonight to speak because in May this year, we put out a report on New Zealand's native birds. So I'm here tonight to talk about Ngā Manu Māori, which are the birds of this wonderful country that we live in. This is actually my second visit to Northland this year. Back in December, I visited Te Rāwhiti Marae and saw the great work they were doing to bring the birds back to the motu of Aupipiri. That's great to have met three friends from there here tonight. But I don't think I've been this far north for more than 40 years. Back in the early 1970s, I was working as a teacher in Hillary College in Ōtara in Auckland. And one of the other teachers became a great friend of mine, and that was Sana Murray, who some of you may know, some of you tonight may be related to her. But Sana took me and another teacher on a trip back up to the very far north, up to Te Hapua, and all the time discussing how things might be made better for her people. And this is how I remember her. She's the one on the right, on your left, looking there. I hadn't thought about her for years until I saw that in 2011 she had passed on to be with her tūpuna. And I hadn't seen her for all that time, and I'd completely forgotten about her, really. And I was so sad that I had missed her, particularly because she was one of the original claimants in the Y262 claim to the Waitangi Tribunal, the claim for the protection and preservation of Indigenous flora and fauna. So we would have had a connection there that we hadn't thought about all those years ago. And when I knew her, I had no particular interest in the environment, but now I would have loved to have caught up with her before it was too late. I also discovered that every day she sat before the Waitangi Tribunal, she wore a fossilised pupu harakiki around her neck, the fossil of a flax snail. These snails belong to the world's oldest land snail family, which originated 200 to 300 million years ago. But the pupu harakiki is a species in trouble. It is threatened with extinction, eaten by the same animals that are killing the birds. And much of what I will talk about tonight is how we can stop these animals from killing our birds. And if we do this, we may save Sana's pupu harakiki as well. This country of ours was once part of a great southern continent that we call Gondwana land, which split up into Australia, New Zealand, South America, Africa. And what happened was that the dinosaurs ran around Gondwana land, but before the mammals evolved, New Zealand split off. And that is why we have dinosaur bones, but we had no native mammals except for a couple of bats that somehow must have flown here across the sea. And so what that means is that the birds that we have are sitting at the top of our ecosystems, which is a very unusual thing globally. And consequently, the birds grew very large because they didn't have to bother to fly. It was one reason. You can see more of there being hunted by the Haast eagle. The Haast eagle was the biggest eagle that has ever lived. It had a wingspan up to 3 metres. Both those, of course, are long gone. And here's another bird, an adzbill that's gone forever. You can think of that one as a weka on steroids. It was nearly 20 kilograms. And this one, here's another one that's gone. Sadly, many of you will recognise the huia, was really special. The male with its short, stubby beak, and the female with a long, curved beak. And so when they ate, you know, the male would pick away, get certain insects, and the female would put her beak down behind the bark. They are the New Zealand birds where the difference in the look of them between male and female is by far the greatest. So, and the last one of those died out for 100 years ago or so. But there are about 50 species of birds that have become extinct and disappeared since humans arrived, but we haven't lost all of them. That's good news. You'll recognise this one, the kookapara in this part of the country, kereru elsewhere, they call it. It would be a great thing if kookapara became so numerous again that it was possible to sustain a customary harvest and illegal teagle could become legal teagle. But we are a long way from that now. Titi were once plentiful around much of the country and also an important source of food, not so much now. James here with me, he worked on these birds on sub-Antarctic islands and down on Rakiura, down there. And you will recognise the toro up this way, the variable oyster catcher. This is one of the birds that breeds inland and spends winter on the coast. But the thing that I'm not a biologist, so I came into this to learn like anyone else. We have 168 species of native birds. And astoundingly, 93 of them are endemic, as we call it. Now, compare this with the British Isles. Only one endemic bird, and there it is. It's called the Scottish Crossbill. And even then, they've got a debate going on about it, whether it's really endemic or not. So we have 93. They have one. And so our 93, I think, are something that are really special. The kiwi in particular is really special and justifies the emphasis we put on it. It goes back about 70 million years. When you look at the evolutionary tree of birds, and you go right back up it, this is on the internet, you can see it. All the birds in the world belong to what they call old jaws or new jaws. And the old jaws are the ones that are kind of like the dinosaurs, close to the dinosaurs. Almost all the birds in the world are new jaws. The kiwi is one that is an old jaw, along with its fellow ratites, as they're known, the emu, the moa, the cassowary, the rhea, and the ostrich, I think, are the ratites. The moa was one too. But they were these birds that evolved in Gondwana land, obviously, because that's where they lived. So the kiwi is really unusual. But we have other birds that are special, and we have three special wattle birds, as they're called, or they're wattles around their necks. Other wattle birds in the world are not like ours. The kukako, with the blue wattles, and the most musical song of all. This is my favourite bird. The tiki, the saddleback, with its orange wattles. There are a few left on islands and in sanctuaries where there are no predators. And the huia was the third one that's gone forever. So those three wattle birds comprise a family of birds that has no other members worldwide. So what I'm trying to convey here is that in turn, our birds are a huge contribution to global biodiversity. It's a bigger issue than just us. And then we've got three parrots that belong to a family with no other parrots in the world, the kaka, the kia, the only parrot in the world that lives in snow. That's pretty unusual when you think about it. And then the kakapo, the only parrot in the world that can't fly. But it's their specialness, really, of all these birds that makes them vulnerable, because they didn't evolve along with mammals and they didn't learn to fly and defend themselves. A kakapo, for example, when it's under threat, it freezes, and you can see from the colour how it blends in with the foliage. And that's because its enemy was the harst eagle flying overhead looking for movement. But when a stoat is the threat, freezing, playing statues, is the very, very last thing you should do. You should learn to fly and get out of there quickly. And this is really, again, it's their specialness, their uniqueness that makes them so vulnerable to these introduced animals. But that's rather a long introduction to this report that we did on New Zealand's native birds. There's the cover of the report. Again, we've got some of those over there. And I want to talk about this report on birds. We called the report Taonga of an Island Nation, the treasure of an island nation, saving New Zealand's birds. The report is based on a vision, and I'm not really given to having visions. It's not really my style, but this one kind of crept up on me. And it was a vision of restoring abundant, resilient, diverse bird life back onto the mainland. And that business of the mainland is important, because what we have now are birds on predator-free islands like this one, Anchor Island in Fiordland. I've actually been to that one, and it's astonishing the growth that you get with it when you have no introduced animals there. And the other place we have a lot of our birds are now in fenced sanctuaries, like that Zealandia in Wellington. Some of you may have visited it. And that's fine. You know, we put them on predator-free islands for a purpose, and we put them in sanctuaries for a purpose. But I want lots of birds back on the mainland, please. So we've got the 168 bird species I referred to earlier. Despite having lost 50, still got 168. And what are they? Where are they? So 41 different species in the forest, 70 in the fields, rivers and coasts, and 57 out at sea. Now, that's a fairly loose classification, but if anyone's interested in the details of where we classify that way, they can ask one of these experts here. But looking at them in more detail, that's what we've got in the forest. And I'm not going to read that out to you. But you can see the range of birds. Actually, the pheo, the duck that lives in the forest, and the whitewater kayaker of the duck world. The rougher, the better. If I start reading them out, I start singing in a partridge in a pear tree, so I prefer not to read them out. But if we look in our fields, our rivers and our coasts, and those are all native birds that we still have left, a great, great range of different kinds of birds. And again, if you get a copy of our report, they're all listed in the back of that. And then there's a heap of seabirds, starting off with four albatrosses. The tropic bird at the bottom is a bit of an imposter. It's in the Kermadecs, and it's just kind of arrived there fairly recently. But we have to put it in, strictly speaking. But that's what they are, great range of different birds and where they are. But how are they doing? And this really is the shock. So what we did was take the official threat classifications as they see them. I don't like the word threat when they talk about dogs. I mean, a stoat doesn't come up to a bird and threaten it. It eats it. It doesn't come up and wag its finger and say, if you're naughty, I'll do such and such. It doesn't worry about that. It doesn't threaten it. It actually eats it. But anyway, the biologists call them threats. They've got their own language of threat classification, but we just took those and translated them into everyday language. And you can see that of that, a third of them are really on their way to extinction if we can't arrest that. About half of them are in some difficulty. And only 20%, one in every five of our species, is really classified as doing okay. And I call that a desperate situation. So what can we do to save them? So if we think about them, they have, birds like other creatures, have three needs. Safety from predators, that's a big one. You've got to be safe. Then you've got to have somewhere to live. You've got to have food and places to nest and enough territory. And thirdly, you need a measure of genetic diversity, because if you've got a bunch of clones and they're all exactly the same genetically, they're not going to be resilient, because if one of them falls prey to some kind of disease, then they'll all go under. So you do need some genetic diversity so you can adapt and evolve. So I'm going to talk about each of those needs in turn, and then I'm going to come back and focus on the first need, the predators, because that's the big difficult one. There are a whole range of, so if we go to the first need, the safety from predators, so most important thing, a whole range of animals that were brought into this country that are killing birds, some brought in deliberately, generally without any concept of the impact they would have on birds, not entirely true, but a lot of them were stowaways. And we generally think of possums first. Our Australian friends, but their impact is more on trees and plants. They're voracious munchers of foliage, and other animals are much more destructive directly of bird life. I mean, the possums really take away the food, but they don't kill it. They will, but not so much. Really big problem are the rodents, the rats and the mice. The Kiori, the Pacific rat, came with the first Polynesian colonists, and that led to some extinctions. The Norway rat, which are the big ones that you find around waterways, they arrived with Abel Tasman and Captain Cook. The ship rat, which most of them are, the great majority of rats you find around are the ship rats, with the wonderful biological name of Rattus, Rattus, Rattus. triply evil. They're called ship rats because they'd run along the mooring ropes to the big ships tied up and get on the ships that way. And of course then they travelled right around the world. So they're very good climbers. If you see rats up in the trees, there'll be ship rats. And then the mouse tagged along with European settlers, and that also plays a role here. But the rats are predators in their own right. They will eat birds, particularly nesting females and chicks, and I'll get back to that. Really, the time in the spring when birds are nesting and you're trying to get the chicks raised, that is the most vulnerable time, of course, for birds. Mice will eat eggs, but importantly, the rats and the mice together provide food for the bigger predators, what we call the mustelids and the feral cats. So looking first at what we call the mustelids, we need a few headings on these slides. The weasel, it's the little one, the stoat, and the ferret. And the prize for the worst mustelid goes to the stoat. And when it comes to, especially when it comes to killing bush birds, the stoat is a clever, sophisticated death machine. And these animals were brought in to deal to the rabbits, but you know they haven't done very well, have they? They're all carnivores. They're all flesh-eating animals. These, and when there's plenty of food for them to eat, and this is particularly the case for stoats, the way their biology works, if there's plenty of rats and mice running around, they will breed prolifically. Every female stoat is pregnant all the time. They are impregnated virtually from birth when a male comes into the nest. And if there is plenty of food and the mother gets plenty of food, female gets plenty of food, she will bring the young to birth, and there can be as many as 12 of them. So the stoats will proliferate when there's lots of rats and mice around. So there's a sort of that very unfortunate dynamic. And then the one that I'm really getting worried about now, the feral cats. The biggest, probably the biggest killer of birds outside the bush. I like that photo, sure. Shows you. But in parts of the country, they're really living it up and multiplying on a diet of fresh rabbit. So they're breeding very fast at the moment. They are the most intractable predator. I visited what's called Cape Sanctuary at Cape Kidnappers in Hawke's Bay, and they've got a very impressive predator-proof fence that I think it's about 2,500 hectares it protects. And they have killed in the last decade more than 1,400 feral cats. And it's one every 2 or 3 days. And that's the cats can only get in by coming along the beach. Because Hawke's Bay, of course, has a plague of rabbits going on. But there are others. Dogs are a particular threat to kiwi. They're very attracted by the smell. They can't resist it. And unfortunately, you know, it's not necessarily always a dog that shakes a kiwi to bits, although some of them might. But kiwis, the kind of birds they are, they lack a bone in their breast called a keel bone because they don't fly and they didn't need a keel bone, so they're weak there. And when a dog can pick up a kiwi and just mouth it in the same way as it pick up a ball, not even, you know, could pick it up quite gently, but it can snap the sternum because the keel bone is not holding the sternum in place as it is in most creatures. And then that broken bone can pierce the lung and it's the end of the kiwi. So even a dog just picking up a kiwi quite gently can inadvertently kill it with no intent to do so. Pigs and their little hedgehog cousins will eat eggs and chicks and other creatures, of course, such as Sana's snail. So I'll come back to predators a bit later, but I want to now go on to the second need that birds have, which is somewhere to live, like all of us, somewhere to live and thrive. Habitat matters too. If we killed off all the predators, but we're left with a desert with no food or good places to nest, birds wouldn't be very happy. And again, we have a bunch of introduced animals that destroy habitat. And right up there is our friend the possum, an animal that is protected in every state of Australia, but obviously really loves New Zealand food and struggles over there. And this is a photo of southern rata on the west coast in flower of the South Island. This is a valley without possums, and this is a valley nearby with possums. And today, we were in a boat on the harbour out here, and we could see the pahutukawa stripped of the leaves by possums around the coast and covered in lichen, which Dean tells me that the scratches left by the possums are where the lichen takes root. Here's another pest. Please shoot as many of these as you can. This is in the King Country. There's actually two goats in that photograph. There's a black one in the background that's fast asleep with a belly full of foliage. Goats are really destructive, and again, they'll eat anything, and they can climb, as some of you will know. Deer also will selectively browse on plants. They will eat the ones they like and leave the others, and in doing that, they change the composition of the bush, the mix of plants. And so, you know, these different animals affect things in different ways. Some are far more serious than others. You know, if the bush, certainly the possum is right up there. But it's not just introduced animals that are a problem. At the top there, we've got a sand dune with native plants, pinyao and spinifex. And those plants keep the sand dunes rolling gently, and they provide nice hollows for birds like dotterels to lay their eggs. But when you get marram grass coming in, it covers absolutely everything. The dunes end up too steep, and what's more, of course, it's perfect cover for predators to sneak up on nesting birds. So weeds are a problem too, but we're a problem ourselves. Inadvertently, the damage that we do directly ourselves without even realising what we're doing. This here, the next slide, is a squashed baby tern that's been run over by the chicks after a four-wheel drive's been through a riverbed. So, you know, there's lots of reasons why the birds are in trouble. A lot of it is inadvertent, just the way it is, but it does mean there's a big challenge here. The third need, so that was predators, habitat. So the third one is this issue of genetic diversity, which turns out to be pretty interesting. A population of birds without enough genetic diversity will become inbred and vulnerable and eventually struggle to breed at all. And sadly, the kakapo is in this situation. One of our three special parrots, the parrot of the night, a super heavy parrot, can't fly, never learned to. They used to be everywhere. They weren't just down in Fiordland, where there's a few left now. They used to be right up here as well, all over the country. There's about 150 now from protecting them on two predator-free islands since, I think, the 1980s. They've managed to breed them up to that level. But unfortunately, they are all genetically very similar, essentially clones of each other, and this is really largely why they struggle to breed. And it's hard to see a long-term future for them, and I can't say write them off. I mean, I'm one of the lucky people. That's me there. With one, this is Sirocco. This is the sort of tame kakapo that thinks it's a person. When it was little, it was ill and they had it in some kind of hospital and looking after it, and it imprinted on people. And so it was quite an experience to have this sort of giant budgie sitting on my arm. And then when I left, you know, he ran after me and looked longingly out the door saying, please come back, he really loves people. But the kakapo is one of our three special parrots, but one of our three special wattle birds I mentioned earlier is the kokako with the blue wattles. And this one is on a predator-free island in the Hauraki Gulf with a small population of these birds. One of them, I don't think this is the one in the photograph, that happens to be called Bandit, that's irrelevant, but it's called Bandit, has actually consorting with his grandmother. Now, I say that might be a happy relationship, but it's not a healthy one. Okay, Bandit's doing fine, but his descendants will be in trouble if this goes on for too long. Another of our special parrots is the kaka. This is one at Zealandia, the sanctuary in Wellington, that keeps birds safe behind a predator-proof fence. These birds have bred well, and you know they're flying over quite a lot of Wellington. People get excited when they see them. Last week I saw one outside Parliament. But all of the kaka in Wellington come from 14 founding birds. Now, we would not put 14 humans behind a fence and tell them to breed like crazy year after year. So sometimes you need a stranger to come into the village and marry one of the local girls. And that applies to birds as well. And we need to mix our birds up a little. The kiwi in one area, for example, may be a little different from the kiwi in another area. And since some people say we should keep them separate because they're special to this area. But when they were plentiful, when they were everywhere, they would have mixed up themselves. So what we've done by putting them on predator-free islands for a very good reason, putting them in sanctuaries for a very good reason, small populations remaining in small areas of bush, inevitably small populations of birds. And they need some genetic diversity. They need a bit of mixing up. We've broken what's called the evolutionary force of migration, when birds would just move around and mix themselves up, as people do. So that's the third thing they need. And I do worry about this genetic thing because it's something that we haven't thought of, and because we've got these small isolated populations in many cases. So the three things, just again, it's predators, it's habitat, and it's that sort of variation. The most urgent of these is the first. And I'm going to spend the rest of my time on this first need. Because if you're a bird, someone's trying to kill you, you haven't got enough food to eat, and you're not sure who to mate with. Well, the first thing, someone to try to kill you, that's the one you're going to worry about the most. So that is the most urgent. The most urgent thing is not to get killed. And here are the main enemies. Again, there's possum eating an egg there. There's a rat eating fantail chicks. No doubt it's already eaten the mother. And a stoat eating a tui. And, of course, the feral cat again, I think the one that we're all underestimating. So what can we do about these predators? We need to actually kill them, I'm afraid. We have to trap them or poison them. It's our only choices at the moment because they're not going to go back to the countries they came from. They're just not. They're here. And if we want our birds, we have to think about how to deal with this. So trapping, a few comments about trapping first. This is an ordinary sort of standard dock trap. Some of you will use these. They're called a dock 200. Some of the good news is that there's quite a lot of innovation going on in trapping, particularly traps that reset themselves. This one here is one where the animal is lured to put its head inside, and there's a gas canister that is then triggered, and the animal gets donged on the head and dies instantly. Great engineering in that trap, great engineering, but the challenge is getting the animal to put their head in the first place. And rats are clever. Stoats are clever. Actually, they're doing very well with possums, I believe. Possums seem to be a bit stupider. But rats and stoats will learn. And so this business of luring them in with things that they can't resist is a big area of research that is very important. For instance, they're experimenting with attracting rats by sound recordings of baby rats. So try to get females in being attracted by the sound of baby rats. In Australia, they're doing a great deal of work on this because their two big pests are cats, wild cats, feral cats and foxes. And they're experimenting with luring the cats in with recordings of cats on heat and another recording of birds in distress to see whatever they can do to get them in. So because, again, cats are very clever too. So beyond trapping, we have bait stations, ground baiting. There's a range of baits used in these. You need to vary those baits every so often because, again, the animals will learn. But there are two situations where you need something more, something different from a trap or a bait station on the ground. And the first of those situations is when you are trying to deal with killing predators over large areas, particularly when those areas are rugged and hard to access. And the second situation in which you've got to have something more than trapping and ground baiting is what is known as a mast. And these mast years occur when, often it's beech mostly, but it can occur with other species as well, where one spring you'll get a very prolific flowering, and this is beech having a prolific flowering and a mast, and then a prolific seeding. And what happens as a result of that is this. So in those graphs, the top one is rats, the bottom one is stoats, and you've got, you can see the great big bump up in the rats. So that's a mast year. When the rat population, they call it erupting instead of erupting for some reason, don't ask me, the rat population goes nuts. And you can see that little time delay and see how the stoat population follows the sort of exploding population of rats. So all of those rats soaring up, and then all the stoats soar up. And the irony of all of this is that the mast years, this is a natural thing that happens in New Zealand, those were the years of plenty for the birds because those were the years when there were plenty of seeds. And so the birds had plenty of food, and they're actually the years of death if you can't stop the mast. And so both of these situations, there's no alternative at the moment to using 1080. And let me just pause for a moment. The name 1080 means absolutely nothing at all. In the 1930s in America, when they were developing it as a toxin, I think, to kill moths at that stage, someone was testing a batch and an invoice was sent for the payment for the testing, and the invoice number was 1080. It means absolutely nothing. There is no 1090 or 1170 or anything else. It sounds sort of sciencey, very sciencey and sort of a bit menacing, but it means nothing at all. But Again, so but there is no alternative for killing predators over large and accessible areas, you know, particularly if they're inaccessible, and when masts occur. And I'm going to spend some time now, and I've been asked to do this, to talk about 1080, because I know there are some concerns, and rightly so, because dropping poison out of the sky is not a trivial thing to do by any means, and you need to be really careful, and we need to know what we are doing. So, as it so happens, I did a report into 1080 some years ago. As I've often said, I knew nothing about it to start with and had no preconceptions at all. And we spent the best part of 2 years in the office reading every single bit of research and following everything up. And I expected to find a lot of problems because there were so many concerns about it. And I was blown away by how useful it is. And it's the first time I actually appeared in a cartoon. There was another one of me recently actually being put into a graveyard by Paula Bennett and Nick Smith, actually, I think, in the Christchurch Press. But you'll notice the possum in my hair, but also notice the cup of tea, because 1080 is a naturally occurring substance in plants, and it actually is present in tea at very low concentrations. It's also present, it seems, in puha at very low concentrations. So it is actually a naturally occurring substance. And this is a plant in Western Australia, which has a really high concentration of 1080 in this family of plants over there. And it's interesting, the plants over there evolved it to stop themselves being eaten by the native animals. And so the native animals over time, over evolutionary time, developed immunity to this. So had our possums come from Western Australia, which would have been stupid because it would have been so far to bring them, they would not be killed by 1080. They're immune to it. But our possums came from New South Wales and Tasmania, so 1080 will actually kill them. So it's interesting. I find that quite fascinating. So anyway, going back to 1080, two big questions really we looked at. Does it work? And secondly, is it safe? And so here's a blue pellet on the ground. Does it work? Absolutely. Possums and rats and mice will eat it and die. Stoats won't eat it because they're carnivores, they're meat eaters, but they will eat the rats and the mice that have died or are dying. And so they are killed. And cats also, feral cats will do this through secondary, what they call secondary poisoning. So the primary poisoning is the animals that actually eat it, and the others eat the animals that have already died from it. Nowadays, these are dyed blue. The doc uses them blue or green so the birds don't actually see it, because one of the things I think to really understand about 1080 is that the practice in the past was terrible. You know, it was brought in the 1950s to control rabbits, and they dropped it around with gay abandon at great concentrations per hectare. The baits were carrots chopped up and soaked in 1080, and of course the orange of the carrots would attract birds, because I think they were berries, and also because carrots being chopped up could be chopped up and you get very small slivers which the birds could eat. So there was bird bykill then, but nowadays it's a very... Can you stop? It's very rare. It actually seems to be only a few kea that are the problem, and that's because kea are curious birds and very difficult to stop them being curious. But the important thing, even with kea, is how many young ones were able to fledge and leave the nest and fly off and be safe. It's all about how many do you get through that difficult spring period and get those adult birds going, keeping them going. But like anything else, using 1080, the effect of it is not permanent. The rats come back. That's almost like a rap song, isn't it? The rats come back. They always come back. They come back first. And this is a graph showing what happened in 2014 in a mast occurring in Fiordland, Dart Valley. The red line at the bottom, the solid red line coming along here, is the rats population. The green arrow coming down is the seeds fallen from the beech trees in huge numbers. The 1080 drop occurred there. It knocked the rats down. This is what would have happened to the rats had they not dropped 1080. And then, of course, the stoats would have come off the back of it. But you can see it comes down and then they start to rise again. So they come back. And so nothing is permanent here. So you need to keep at it. Another change that's happened, important change that's happened with 1080, this, you can't see it, it's not very easy to read, but this is the 1970s, 20 kilograms of bait per hectare. 2010, it's down to two, you know, a tenth of it, and now it's down to 1.5 kilograms of bait per hectare, and that's not 1080, because the 1080 is just part of the bait. So it's very heavily regulated. I think it was regulated, we found, under 18 different laws. As it should be, because you are dropping poison out of the sky and you have to be very, very careful. But one of the concerns is about water. What happens to 1080 when it gets into water? And I want to spend a bit of time on this because I know people worry about it. Three things. First thing, leaching. The 1080 slowly leaches out of the bait, and that, about half of it comes out in the first 2 hours, and most of it's out in 24 hours. So it's quite a slow process where it leaches out. The second thing that happens is dilution. It just floats around. It's just, imagine, it's almost like a teaspoon of salt and you're dripping it out very slowly, and then it just dilutes around. Of course, the more water is faster flowing, the faster it dilutes. And then it is broken down by bacteria into harmless substances, and that breakdown, it is biodegradable. It also happens if it lands on soil, by the way. The breakdown by bacteria happens in somewhere between 2 and 6 days. That's the variable time it takes. So, and then it is gone. It is absolutely gone. You can't say the same for all of the poisons that are used. So moving, we've done some calculations in my office. If you imagine a small forest stream and a bait falls in, you know, and the big baits are 12 grams, the smaller ones are 6 grams. If you suppose for a second that all the 1080 in that bait leached out just like that, which of course it doesn't, it takes over 24 hours, but imagine all of it came out at once. And we worked out how long, and we worked out a flow rate, typical flow rate for a stream like that, how long before that 1080 was diluted to what the Ministry of Health says is a safe drinking water level of water with 1080 in it. It is like a second. It is just virtually instant, because it actually just dilutes so fast. And of course, imagine it all leaches out instantly, which it doesn't. So it's just dripping out very, very slowly, diluting. And that safe Ministry of Health level, by the way, is the safe level as if you drank water with 1080 in it at that concentration for your entire life. So really, there is actually no risk at all for it falling in water. I think the risks that come, there's certainly 1080 will kill dogs. You have to be very careful with dogs. Keep them away from it. They're very sensitive to it. I think as far as humans have been, there's been one death in the 1960s with, they used to, for some reason, at some stage they were putting it in strawberry jam for some reason, and somebody's reputedly put it on his toast. But it's thought it was probably a suicide. But I think the real risk to humans is possibly a small child sees a blue and thinks it's a lolly, you know, it's going to pick this up. But the baits, those cereal baits, are actually extremely hard. You couldn't bite through them. So, but you do have to watch children, I think. But they do break down quickly on the ground. And, of course, the rats eat them pretty fast. Lots of testing being done. Does it affect tuna? Does it affect eels? This is a longfin tuna. We've done a report on that. Got a few copies over there, longfin tuna, kufarafaru. And they've done experiments where they've had eels and they've fed possums, dead possums, to them that have been killed by 1080. So, and force-fed them with these possums. And basically the result was to risk death, because the eels would get a little bit of 1080 inside them for a time, but it would break down inside the eels. You'd have to eat 5 tons of eel at one sitting to risk death. All right, so these are just down to just really, really, really low levels. Pigs, I think now the low sowing rates make it very unlikely to kill a pig, particularly an adult pig, because if a pig eats something it disagrees with, it generally vomits it up. If a pig does get some 1080 inside it, again, like humans or eels or anything else that gets 1080 inside, it breaks down, it's metabolized by the system of the animal itself. It doesn't do anything to the DNA. Someone asked me about that last night. It's just broken down naturally as part of it because, you know, there are plants with it in. It just happens to be a compound inside plants. But again, with pork, if you're eating pigs, you'd have to eat an impossibly large amount to get sick at all. And what DOCS does now, of course, they have the warning signs up for around 6 months, and they put a number of pellets and carcasses of, say, dead animals that have died from it inside a cage, and then they're able to monitor it, those up to 6 months, because the amount in, say, a dead possum can stay there quite a bit longer inside the carcass than if the 1080 was on the soil or in the water where it's gone, you know, in a week. And it can, usually it is completely gone from the possum carcasses well within the 6 months. The one case in situation where it tends to last longer is in cold, dry weather, which is not Northland. I've realised that. So again, this is, but you would need to keep your dogs away for as long as those warning signs are up. But I want to just leave 1080 here for a moment and go back to the vision. I want birds back in Northland and the rest of the country that are abundant and diverse and resilient. And to achieve this is going to take a lot more than what DOC can do. And there are over 800 different community groups working around the country to restore what has been lost. Here's one group here releasing robins back into a part of Taranaki that they've cleared it of predators, so it's safe for them to go back. Here's another situation where people are working hard at planting up, because habitat, of course, is enormously important as well. And it's not just about the bush. This is a group of people working to restore native plants on sand dunes north of Wellington. And nearer here, there's this group some of you will know called Backyard Kiwi, who do a great job in the Whangaroa Peninsula. And here, the Hapu, who've been working on the Warra Warra Forest, and I want to acknowledge them for supporting the 1080 drop on that forest. So just to finish off, ka ora te Ngāhere, ka ora manu Māori, ka ora ai te iwi. If the forest is well, the birds will be well, and the people will be well. Thank you.